In this episode of AnimeCons TV, Doug and Elizabeth talk about their experience at Anime USA. We have an interview with Roland Kelts, and Year in Review, where we tell you everything we thought about this year of 2011.
Doug and I recently went to Anime USA again for the second year in a row, and it was held at the Hyatt Crystal City, as it was last year in the past few years. And even though we just got back yesterday, I'm still kind of tired because we did a lot of stuff. There was a lot of stuff to do, and it does make a good wind down year of the end of the year convention. But even though there was a lot to do, I feel like Sunday was very boring,
which is weird. Yeah, it's definitely a con that if there's panels or events that you want to go see, you're going to have a great time. But if you're trying to fill time between things that appeal to you, there's only so much you can do. Mm-hmm. And some of that, I mean, the game room was cool to check out. Like, they actually had a Japanese iPad game, which I've never seen in a video game room before.
It was awesome. I bought it. but you can only walk around the dealer's room and the artist alley so many times for, like, okay. It seemed like maybe it's just things that didn't appeal to us, but it seems like main programming it was kind of missing. Mm. They had cosplay chess on a Saturday morning, like at 11, and usually I see that on Sundays. It's a very good Sunday event, and I don't know why they didn't have it on Sunday, but I actually ended up taking an earlier flight back home because I'm just like, all right, I think it's time to go.
Mm-hmm. But I think one of the things that really makes the events worthwhile, especially if you go to Anime USA, you got to go to their panels. The panelists they get are phenomenal. Mm-hmm. The way I've described it to a bunch of friends has been, if you want panelists that know how to tell stories and interact with your audience, this is the con for you. I mean, so many just great people to talk to and everything and really engage the audience instead of just kind of sit down and listen to a lecture.
Yeah, they were definitely very good speakers, very charismatic, knew what they were talking about. And I don't know if it's just because they get the same panelists every year or the panelist director seeks out certain people or people just submit really good applications for their panels, but I went to some really great panels. Mm. And it's not very often I get a lot of really great panels.
Yeah, and the big news for next year is that they are changing locations, which is kind of a mixed thing. I mean, I think they've outgrown the Hyatt Regency. I mean, they had the gaming tables in the hallway, which was sometimes really frustrating when you're trying to get the point A to point B. But I think they could have looked at other options within the Crystal City area because there's a lot of great restaurants, the airport's right there, you know, the Renaissance Hotel is there, and there's a lot of function space they could have moved there, and that's literally across the street.
Mm-hmm. If you know, if you've been to KatsuCon before, it's moving to the Marriott that's next to the Omni that they used to be at. So it's a little ways away from where it was in Crystal City. There are some good food options in the area. It doesn't look like there's as many hotels, but I looked at the function space and it looks like there's a lot more room, which is great because it was getting really crowded. Because the problem is the main floor lobby is this little area where the escalators meet, that was just a constant crowd. And the staff was doing their best to make sure people moved along, but, you know, someone stops to take a picture, and then, you know, people are stuck everywhere. And it is surrounded by a lot of lounge space. The problem is at 3 o'clock, you can only sit there if you're paying for food because it's technically part of the restaurant.
I think, though, that you touched upon, you know, people kind of always stopping in front of escalators. I mean, the staff did the best good. The only other negative I would really give the con is that they scheduled panels and events to have like 15 minutes between each thing, but this wasn't put into the schedule. Mm-hmm. It looked like one panel ended and the other one began.
Right, and a lot of conventions do this. It showed I believe it was a 90-minute block, say from like 11 to 1:30.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, but it didn't show that there were technically 15 minutes for the room to clear and then, you know, people to go from where they point A to point B for other panels and for people to leave, people come in, which I think every convention should do. It shouldn't be panel ends at 3, next panel starts at 3. That doesn't happen. See what I said earlier about Nobuo Uematsu. but I think it's good that more conventions are doing this. They just need to make people more aware.
Yeah. And lastly, we talked about the meeting space where you had to buy stuff. I would like to just kind of give a nod. It was cool that we did a meetup for mm-hmm. AnimeCons TV, and a group of people came to join us. So I definitely hope people can do that next year. So yes. Follow us on Twitter.
So we're here with Roland Kelts, author of Japan America, and we're going to ask him a couple quick questions about what his experiences with conventions. So, first off, what was your first convention experience like, anime or otherwise?
Let's see. I had been to some, I guess what you could describe as academic conventions or book-oriented conventions, but they are generally much less colorful mm-hmm. than anime and manga conventions, and obviously that's partly because of cosplay,
mm-hmm.
But also because of the age of the participants. One of the things that's exciting about the anime cons is just that there are quite a few young people who have a lot of energy and who clearly have a lot of passion for the community mm-hmm. that's created around Japanese popular culture.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm trying to think of which one was, I can't, right off the top of my head, can't recall my first one
mm-hmm.
exactly, but I know that I was astonished by the enthusiasm. Mm-hmm. And as a writer, I think kind of nourished because I've done book tours, and of course, in those situations you're usually in a bookstore or you're in a university. But to be around so many people who are expressing this passion out in the hallways, and then come in and sit down and join you to for talk
yeah.
and discussion. And then come up and get the book signed and talk to you about the book. And that's really rewarding
mm-hmm.
because writing is a pretty solitary experience.
And do you have a particularly favorite moment from some of your convention experiences, like just a certain memory that stands out in your mind and just kind of the crowning moment of awesome or something?
The crowning moment of awesome. Well, there are a lot of moments that are quite, I think, rewarding mm-hmm. at cons. I feel like I'm kind of lucky because I have something of a niche
mm-hmm.
to fill at a convention. I'm obviously not a voice actor, so it's not mm-hmm. a bunch of fawning fans for voice acting, and I'm not specifically an industry person,
mm-hmm.
so I it's not my job to announce the new releases or, mm-hmm. Shape the company's brand. I kind of am able to exist to the side a bit and talk about the culture, the two cultures, and that experience. So I do remember at one con that I attended a few years ago, a gentleman stood up with the first edition hardcover of the book and said that his wife had purchased it for him for Christmas. Because the first edition of the book came out just before Christmas, and that it immediately became one of his favorite books, and that he had held on to it until he could meet me and get it signed. And that seemed quite moving, because it isn't a novel, obviously, and it's not necessarily a personal book, and there's some personal information in it, but that he had held on to it and coveted it, and to get it signed was quite moving.
Okay, and lastly, where can people find out more about what you're up to? What are some of the best ways to find out what you're doing and find out more about you?
There's a blog for the book, Japan mm-hmm. America, which is where the focus is generally on Japanese pop culture and Japanese mm-hmm. culture, literary mm-hmm. culture, and so I post some things there. I usually post the publications, so I write about Japanese politics and society for Adbusters magazine.
Mm-hmm.
I've done book reviews for the Wall Street Journal. So I kind of write a variety of different voices, different mm-hmm. kinds of things. But generally, stuff is posted on the Japan America site. I also do a regular radio segment for National Public Radio, and I think I post those links usually. Mm-hmm. Somebody posts them. So yeah, I think that's where. I mean, you know, I have a novel mm-hmm. should be out next year, and I'm working on another nonfiction project. And at some point, I think it's too early right now, but at some point, because I've been asked to, I think I'll revisit some of this territory. And in fact, mm-hmm. I think there would be a really, someone, and I'm sure someone's working on it, should write a really good book about the conventions themselves, mm-hmm. because they're unique. And I still think it's astonishing that tens of thousands of people show up just about every weekend yeah. to celebrate a culture so far away.
Great. Well, thank you for taking the time to speak with us.
Cheers. Thanks.
Year in review!
Yay! Another year is over.
Okay.
Alrighty.
So here at the AnimeCons TV, we do a year in review where we have a list of questions we ask ourselves and we give you the answers. So, alright, let's just go off of the thing. What was our favorite convention moment? Patrick.
Mine was at Animane, where I got to operate a steamroller and run over bootlegs as part of their bootleg bomber event.
That was my idea.
It was Greg Ayers, Colin, the con chair, and Jekka and myself as part of the Chibi project, and loaded bootlegs and ran them over.
Bastard didn't invite
so
us.
So watch that. Watch for that in the Chibi project.
That's awesome.
Well, let's continue on, Elizabeth.
I got to see Nobuo Uematsu again, and this time he was like 10 feet away from me at the panel at Otakon. It was awesome.
Yeah, she could spit on him.
Yes,
jealous.
Jess?
I had a lot of really fun moments, so I just picked one of my favorites is at Dragon Con. We were all hanging out Friday night at Pulse, and we got Doug dressed up as Jane to make it rain.
I was dressed up as Jane.
Well, we put the hat on you.
That's true.
We did. And the hand, and we had the fake money from the Alliance from Firefly, and he threw it over the balcony to all the con goers. It was like, with a make it rain, and like, nobody noticed. But it was pretty funny.
And don't do that.
We don't endorse that at all.
We turned into that guy for a moment.
All right. Well, mine was at PortCon. I brought out my TARDIS, and it happened to be that all the guests were Whovians. So I was just sitting there geeking out with them, and it was just funny because they all were like, well, this was the TARDIS history, right? And I'm like, yeah, I know my stuff. Want to go in the box? Just go in the box. It's got the phone. It's got the phone. Just get in there. Shh. But yeah, that was the best part. It was just celebrities just geeking over something that I created with his money. but it was just great. Doug?
I'd have to say my favorite moment this year was at Otakon, seeing the premiere of the Makoto Shinkai movie. I mean, that it had just come out in Japan literally days before, and they not only had a premiere of it, they had, you know, subtitle track. I would love to know how much of an all-nighter someone did to get that finished ready so people could see it, and that was amazing, seeing that in the High Def Theater and talking with other people who are journalists with anime sites like ANN and Otaku USA and getting their perspective afterward. That was just so awesome. He's a great director and it's cool that you get to see new stuff that soon.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
All right, well, cool. We did our favorite moments. Let's go full 180. What was our least favorite convention moment this year?
Mine was at Aresia. I was part of the podcast panel, and nobody showed up. Not a single person. And I suspect that's because they scheduled it against a shadow cast of Dr. Horrible's sing-along blog, which is where we all went after 10 minutes when nobody was there.
Elizabeth?
Well, this is kind of weird because it also has to do with the Nobuo Uematsu panel, but it was my least favorite moment because, honestly, I don't think it was handled well by Otakon. They didn't clear the room out beforehand until, like, the panel was supposed to start, and then there's this ginormous line of people trying to get in, and the panel didn't start till half an hour late, and it had a hard finish when it was supposed to end. So what was supposed to be an hour of him talking was only half an hour, and I think that was a real missed opportunity, and I was a little bummed, but at least I got in.
You hear that, Otakon? She was bummed. Don't do that again. Jess?
My least favorite is actually at PortCon, the garage sale. Now, First of all, I love the garage sale. I think it's great. We all actually made some extra cash and we got some cool stuff. So the event itself, fantastic. But going into it, you have to bring all this stuff, and people brought cartloads of stuff. Like, I had a lot of stuff. He had tons more than I did. There were several other guests there that had even more than he did. And we had to get there and individually check in each item, one person at a time. And it took forever. And then the dealer's room opened while we're all still doing it. And people are trying to buy stuff around us. And we're all sitting there with piles of junk trying to... Oh, it was just a mess. And I was like, oh. So they need to figure out some way to streamline that. And it'll be much better. But hopefully they can figure something out.
Well... my least favorite moment has to deal with inebriated people, specifically at Kineticon. We go into one of the bars, restaurants located in the Marriott, and we're sitting there, and we get the nice table, and then there's a little nook table next to us, and I'm sitting next to this guy, and he has a help dog, or he's claiming it's a help dog, and... for some reason, he decides he wants to be in our conversation, order Patrick's meal for him, and stuff like that. And then he just...
I was going to have a bacon cheeseburger anyway.
Well, yeah.
Well, it's a good thing he knew what you wanted. Yeah.
But then he just... He can't sit up, and he falls over with his drink and gets my entire left leg.
And the dog.
And the dog.
Seat,
the poor dog was sitting there so nicely.
Yeah. It was, you know, the dog was so well-behaved. And so then, as we're sitting there, we're getting eyed by the people at the bar because they think he's with us. Because of his communication with us. And then the management with three cops comes in to like, okay, sir, we need you to leave. And he starts going off about, it's the dog. The dog is trained. It's not harming anybody.
Well, then he said it was the dog's fault the drink got spilled.
Yeah, and like, I was just like, all right. I'm sitting there. And then when they finally got him to leave, I went, rah! And then had my meal. So that was my least favorite moment. Doug, what was yours?
My least favorite moment, it's a little bit of a pride issue, I'll totally admit, but this was Otakon, and it's funny, you know, both my favorite and least favorite moment were at the same convention, but at Otakon, they put the panel I ran, which was Underrated Mecha, against the Masquerade, which I don't have a problem with because I think every con needs good counter-masquerade programming because not everyone wants to go. But at the same time, we were up against a Sunrise Company panel and a screening of Gundam Unicorn. So basically, you had three events that were all, you know, the same demographic, and there was a lot of people who contacted me either by Twitter or other means and just said, I wanted to go to this event, but they scheduled all these things that were the same thing simultaneously, and it was really frustrating because it was just that one little block of time Saturday night, and nothing was really spread out, where if they had kind of taken a step back, looked at their schedule and said, wait a minute, people are interested in this, are going to want to see this, let's schedule them at different times so they can all see them. And I think it's just kind of paying attention to more of the genre of things. And that, I mean, we still got a good turnout, but it was really frustrating to hear a lot of people come to me later and say they were bummed they missed it.
Well, all of us, other than reviewing things, are also cosplayers. And since we had a big year of costumes, what was your favorite costume that you wore this year?
Mine would have to be 11th Doctor at Dragon Con in the tuxedo from Big Bang at Amy Pond's wedding. And so I was in the parade dancing. It was great.
My favorite was I did Yui from Fushigi with my friend Gail. She did Miyaka, and we did those art scroll images. And I think it's my favorite because it's just a really beautiful costume, and we won awards for it. That was at Anime Boston.
My favorite was Queen Frostine. I finally got to remake it the way I wanted to make it the first time. And so it was kind of like a dream costume come true for me.
Being part that I was King Candy with her is always one of the best costumes I wear every year because it just gets so much notoriety. But I have to say that I was actually very glad that my Rick Castle from the TV show Castle got some, you know, notoriety for, you know, popping up every once in a while, even when I'm surrounded by My Little Ponies.
My favorite was I made the Infinity Gauntlet prop, and that was a great experience to learn how to do a lot of prop making, and the people that saw it and recognized it absolutely loved it and got us some great pictures with it.
Well, it's a conventions of guests. Well, what was our favorite guest of the year?
Let's start down there this time.
Let's start down there. All right.
I'm going to have to say, I'm going to do a twofer, J. Michael Tatum and Chris Ayers at PortCon. Absolutely hilarious in their panel. You could tell they're thick as thieves, great storytellers, great company, and very personal people. You wanted to talk to them and learn more about their stuff.
I'm going to kind of go away from the anime, and I'm actually going to say Carrie Fisher. She's actually come out and has embraced her past when it comes to her movies, but it was just so funny to watch her panels, and she's sitting there just like, oh yeah, George Lucas can bleep, 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 light up a cigarette, and then go, oh, Harrison Ford, I totally would have done him backstage. You know, and it was hysterical just to see her, even in some of a train wreck, as some people might call her, but she was great.
I'm going to have to say meeting Gates McFadden and Brent Spiner from Star Trek The Next Generation. I grew up watching them as a really young kid, and so it was kind of like seeing your childhood heroes for the first time. And they were both super nice. Gates McFadden's still gorgeous, even though she's probably older now, and it was really cool.
Well, besides Nobuo Uematsu, I was actually going to say Steven and Doug, so I'm going to go non-anime again and say Edward James Olmos, going to his panel, and then at the end, being able to repeat So Say We All when he says So Say We All, the like highlight of Dragon Con. That was amazing.
Mine would have to be Sylvester McCoy, the Seventh Doctor. He was just hanging out with fans at Dragon Con, and then when it was time to leave, he walked by me. I was dressed as the 11th Doctor. And he shook my hand, looks up, and says, oh, you're a tall doctor. You look like my friend Stephen Fry. Yeah, I've heard that before. And he says, oh, it was nice to meet you. And then he walks off. Like, I shook the 7th Doctor's hand. And before that, he was at the Jonathan Colton concert. So, I mean, it was awesome. He played the spoons there. And then he was watching right in front of me. Just, yeah.
Well, conventions have panels. What were our favorite panels?
Doug.
I put him on the spot.
Yeah, you did. I'd have to say my favorite panel, this was at Anime USA, actually. There was a panel called You've Never Read That. It was all about new manga to check out and recommending all sorts of different stuff. And just, I came back with a huge list of like, okay, I need to start this series and this series and this series. And it's going to drain my wallet as a result, but it was very informative, and the panelists really kind of got into what makes each series good.
I kind of lacked on the panels this year, so the only thing panel experience I have is my own panel, Props and Bleep. Generally, it's just a panel I do all the time, just I renamed it now, but it was probably the smoothest I've ever ran it. I had the most people in the panel, and other than the fact that it was kind of hard to hear me because of logistics of the door in the hallway, it probably was the most successful one I've had.
I'd say panel-wise, I'm going to say Jenny's Rule 34 panel at PortCon because it's freaking hilarious. That's kind of like my joke one, but the one I really want to talk about is at PortCon, also Mookie ran a writing panel. And he is an amazing writer, but he's more of an amazing speaker. And as a writer myself, watching him and watching his passion for it and getting people's ideas from the audience and giving them really great tips on how to critique their own work, I mean, he was just fascinating to watch, and he was so into it, and you don't see that a lot.
My favorite event was the Sci-Fi and Fantasy Masquerade at Costume Con 29 down in New Jersey. If you're like me and would rather see really pretty costumes on stage than really boring, stupid skits like you see at Los Angeles conventions, you will really appreciate Costume Con's masquerades because they are just gorgeous, and I could watch the DVD I bought of that every day.
My favorite event, I did Chibi Project Anime and Scripted at PortCon Maine was the best ever, but my favorite event of 2011 has to be the Foo Fighters at BlizzCon. I don't even have to explain.
Well, I do have to explain one thing for us. Tapped on the shoulder by security.
Yeah, and they said, sir, please step off of that chair. And then I look down, I look at him, and he says, oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't on a chair. I was just standing there.
He's just tall, giant boy.
Yeah.
All right, before we get to the ending of this, we do have the Better Luck Next Year Award. Does anyone have a nominee for this event?
I'll nominate Animane. It was their first year, and they wanted... they said that they capped the attendance at about 300 people a day, and their final attendance was 145. So, better luck next year.
Anyone else?
I'm going to nominate Kineticon. They were pretty disorganized this year. Their program guide was a disaster. If anybody looked at it, they had the wrong bios of the wrong people and the wrong pictures. And
double the pictures.
And
did you notice the layout was last year's?
Yeah, and they had people in there as guests who were guests last year who weren't even guests this year. So that didn't make them look good. And also, their masquerade was out of control for length. I was a judge in it. They went over by over an hour and a half.
And cut
into the next event. And what drove it over was the fact they tried to make their own skits between every skit. And then when it did run over, they didn't cut that stuff out or try to taper down any of the stuff their staff had planned, which is really when someone has to step up and say, look, guys, we're running over. We need to cut this down and get it moving. And nobody stepped up to the plate. So they really need to work on that for next year.
And as we said in the review, Kineticon has, these are problems they can fix, and I think that's kind of their charge for next year.
Yep.
All right, go quickly down the line. Is our favorite conventions of 2011?
Mine was South by Southwest, but considering I didn't actually buy a badge, and I just went to all the parties around the convention, and I mean, it's not even a fan convention. It's music festival, film festival, and interactive, but BlizzCon. I had a blast there. I got to try out Mists of Pandaria, Diablo 3, and the new StarCraft expansion, which is really like a part 2. And the costumes were amazing. And then Foo Fighters. It ends with Foo Fighters. So,
great. I'm going to have to go with PAX East, because I am just obsessed with video games. And it really helped that they moved to the Boston Convention Center. It's definitely a facility that fits them a lot better than the Heinz, and I got to see L.A. Noire before it came out, Child of Eden, and then 8 bazillion other games. I could try the 3DS before it came out, and I just love being able to do those kind of things, and there's never a line for the ladies' room.
Always a plus. I'm going to go with a perennial favorite. Dragon Con was my favorite con again this year. Same reasons as always, great panels, great guests, great events. The parade, I marched in it for the first time. That was fantastic. I danced with Patrick. I was wedding Amy, and we had a great time. But the thing I want to point out about one of the things that's great about Atlanta that we did this year at Dragon Con is we actually took time to see more of the city around the convention. I think a lot of times people travel for these cons, and they go to places they don't normally go, and then they don't leave the con. And it's worth taking the extra day at the beginning or the end to see what's around there. Like, we went to the Olympic Centennial Park this year. We went to the aquarium, which is one of the best in the country.
I saw where they filmed The Walking Dead.
So it's worthwhile. It's worth going out of your way a little bit. And it was a lot of fun.
Well, because I knew DC was going to be nominated. I want to say PortCon was probably my favorite con. It's small. It has its problems like every con does. But it was, the atmosphere was always positive, and everyone has a good time there. And it's... a lot of the memories are coming from that con, so PortCon.
I'm going to go with Otakon. I mean, it's the best con if you're really into the anime industry to find out about new stuff. I mean, I found out so many different titles I need to check out because people are either cosplaying or just talking about it. I mean, one of my favorite shows that I watched this year, I found out about Otakon, and that's been the way it has been for every year I've gone, all 11. I always find something new.
Cool. All right, we do this podcast. We have all the stuff that we don't show you and some of the stuff that we have shown you. So for us, what was our favorite AnimeCons TV moment of 2011? Doug?
I'm going to go with the interviews. I got to meet a lot of cool people this year because I said, hey, we want to interview for our podcast. Will you talk to me at this con? And most of the time they're like, yeah, sure. And it was awesome.
I have to say the introduction of voicemails.
Voicemails!
we introduced them last year, but nobody called.
But it says something when, you know, you go to cons and you do stuff and, you know, Doug said to us before, it's like, you know, he gets recognized. But when I get voicemails, when people are, you know, going, why would you sell your toys at PortCon? And totally slandering me on, you know, Misty, but I don't have one.
The really cute voicemail from episode 309.
Oh, that girl?
Yeah.
Girl,
like,
yeah.
Hey, your AnimeCons, right?
That's awesome.
I hit my knee.
I mean, you hear somebody talk about how great they enjoy the podcast. It means so much to us.
I've been, you know, put in the bloopers of going, oh, I just reduced some voicemails. I actually love doing the voicemails. Please bring them on in. It's great.
All right, you're doing them this month.
All right, yay!
I mean, I didn't really have a really silly moment from this year. Usually I have some crazy blooper I really like, but this year I'm going to have to say interviewing Brian Brushwood. I mean, it was our first interview I did for the podcast, and it was a great time. He's great to talk to.
That was your first one?
Yeah.
Right, I'm going to give you more.
and it's amazing. I mean, it is, you guys keep saying, oh, it's just a small little fan, you know, club, but I mean, it's swimming with people. This hotel is maggoty with fans. I mean, 2,000 people all crammed in here. It's awesome.
Yeah, it's really cool. I mean, they managed to put everybody in such a small space.
Mine was also an interview, and I interviewed J. Michael Tatum because he's really awesome, extremely easy to talk to, and really loves what he does, and kind of just like the fandom in general, too.
Mm. And how was that experience as a guest?
It was strange. I had been to a lot of cons when I was younger and was very much a part of that culture. And being on the other side of it, where now, you know, I'm the one signing autographs, and it was really weird. It was hard getting used to because I didn't like the clear separation between fans and myself.
My favorite moment is one that made me laugh the most, looking back, and it was when Jess was reading an email in the February episode and said, this next email comes from Doug, and she starts reading it, and it's not from Doug, it's from somebody else.
This month's mailbag comes from Doug. Doug writes, can you please...
Wait, what? No, it's not.
Oh! you see,
Doug was originally supposed to do this one,
but now you're doing it. And that name just happens to be there. But if you notice right down there, after the email.
All right, this month's mailbag comes from Parker. And that's not his first name. Well, you know, just have Shiva's hate mails, okay. All right.
It's because Doug was supposed to do it, right?
Yeah, Doug was supposed to do it.
What I do love, too, is that we've gotten such into a groove, too, is that when we have mess-ups that we sometimes correct each other, and it just makes it better and more organic anyway. Like when we call 1-800-ETIQUETTE.
Etiquette.com.
But those are great things. Well, all right. Here, we're done. I'm sure he's like, could you stop talking so I can edit this a lot easier? But we have our predictions. We want to predict what's going to happen in 2012. And let's go, Patrick.
I said you go first this time.
Me? I'll go first. All right. I'm going to say PETA will get a wind of furrydom, and have formal protests across the street from every major convention next year. They go after Mario, now they're going to go after furries.
Okay. I say tragedy ensues on day 3 of Anime Boston when a clearance sale on pony ears in the dealer's room incites a stampede of Friendship is Magic cosplayers. Hundreds are trampled and some are even gored by unicorn horns. The day will live in infamy.
Oh my god, mine has to do with ponies too.
They're everywhere.
I don't know if you noticed the past couple years you've seen a big infusion of Doctor Who into the anime convention world.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing stopping these ponies. They're everywhere. Love it.
Alright, Doug?
Well, crap, now I feel bad, but I'm going to say there's going to be an epic throwdown between the pony cosplayers, the Doctor Who cosplayers, and the Homestuck cosplayers.
Oh God, Homestuck!
Who can and trying to see who can take over an anime con as not being not being anime.
So much Homestuck
now. Well, mine is that the big in-demand guest for 2012 is going to be the Chibi Project.
Yeah!
ChibiProject.com or go look for booking.
Shameless plug.
We'll do a panel.
Shame. So that is AnimeCons TV 2011 Year in Review.
Yay!
Voicemails! Yes, I'm going to do that every single time. But voicemails for December.
Hello. Calling your voicemail service. I really like watching your show. It gives me all sorts of information that I wouldn't be able to easily retrieve off the internet. I just hope you had more episodes about reviews and stuff. It's Carlos. Okay, bye.
Well, thank you, Carlos. Well, we'll definitely plan that for 2012 then. We have another voicemail.
There's no time to explain. Here's what you'll need to do. 1 2/3 cup water. 3 tablespoons of cornstarch. 5 tablespoons of cocoa. Mix water, cornstarch, and cocoa until smooth. Stir in 14 ounces of sweetened condensed milk and 3 egg yolks. Stir in 2 tablespoons clarified butter. Add 1 teaspoon vanilla. Cool slightly by stirring occasionally. Place mixture in 9-inch pie shell of your choice. Om nom, om nom nom nom.
Well, I guess he's now...
Just a friendly reminder about the recipe for chocolate cream pie. Please be sure to cook the contents, as I would hate to not see this show every month. You guys are amazing. Have a great holiday.
Thank you. I thought you were trying to give us salmonella. But remember, if you want to try out that recipe, just keep playing back the podcast until you get the recipe fully down. And thank you again, Movie Phone Guy. Well, remember to email us or follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and now Google+. It's new. And don't forget to leave us voicemails at 762-ADEQUATE. And the whole number thing is right there, too. And we'll see you in Season 4, 2012. Will there be one? We don't know. You'll have to tune in and find out. Bye. Bye!
That's not all the time.
So,
email us at AnimeCons@AnimeCons.tv. I don't know.
All right, we gotta go.
So the sound on that might be weird because halfway through the mic slid down my shirt.
Hold on, and you got that on tape! Like,
say something. Here, has it out.
It'll be right here, so I don't know.
And voicemails, call us at 762 762 adequate. 762 blah 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 blah. It's all right here, you know. You know this by now.
The end.
The end!